citizen-led successes in electoral and political reforms. So I don't want to kind of, there's no way we can overemphasize the importance and the relevance of this subject. Each word in itself has, is very heavily loaded. So I'm not going to talk about it. Talk and I'll leave that to Dr. Shastri, just introduce him a little bit. Let me just read a few things which I have with me here. He obtained his PhD from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology and did his BTech from IIT Delhi and an MBA from Ahmedabad. And he's currently a professor at the Indian Institute of Management in Bangalore. Prior to joining Bangalore, he was a faculty member in the Institute of Management at Ahmedabad. He's the chairman and founder of the Association for Democratic Reforms, ADR, and has spearheaded several initiatives, including the filing of PIL in follow-up to ensure disclosure of criminal record assets and educational background by candidates in the Indian elections, setting up a nationwide network of NGOs under the banner of the National Election Watch to ensure wide availability of the data disclosed by the candidates to voters, and so on. And there's a whole lot of things which he has contributed at a very, very remarkable contribution, I must say, to this very critical area. So without spending more time from my side, I invite Dr. Shastri to talk to you and would like to welcome Dr. Shastri once again. Thank you, sir, for coming.
Insisted that I should give a talk. This is the title that we gave, Citizen-Led Successes in Electoral and Political Reforms. Rather than getting very conceptual, I'll just tell you the story. I think all of you are intelligent people and you will be able to draw your own lessons from it. So the motivation really is that, you know, a lot of us, we complain a lot, and I'm really addressing our young friends, students, VTech, MTech, PhD students who are here, of course the respected faculty members as well, and others. We complain a lot about the state of affairs in the country. And many of you have the privilege of living in Uttar Pradesh. I know that many people complain even more bitterly when they are living here. So back in 98-99, we also used to complain a lot. We still do, but we thought, in America there is a saying, you know, don't get mad, get even. So what's the point of getting angry, do something about it. So we were wondering, what do? And the motivation really started off, you know, when I was a little bit older than some of you BTech students. There was a 84 scam called the Bofors scam. It probably happened before most of you were born, but you might have heard about it. So a former prime minister had been sort of accused of bribery and corruption. After that, there was the next prime minister who had 6 criminal cases against him. He was actually convicted of one of them. And then you had CMs from Uttar Pradesh and Bihar and Tamil Nadu and various places who were involved in various scams. So it was bothering me a lot that why is my country being hijacked by such people and what is my role and what can we do? So the problem was that we had no money, we had no power, no influence, nothing, no political backing, just ordinary students or whatever, ordinary citizens back then. So we thought that we would go to the court, the Supreme Court, because there is this option which, if intelligently used, can bring about some results, called the public interest litigation. So one had heard that there is an organization in Delhi back then called Common Cause, it's still there, which was founded by Mr. H.D. Shuri, who till the age of 95 used to very fastidiously and consistently go on filing cases in the Supreme Court against various injustices. In fact, his son gave you a big grant in IIT Delhi, in IIT Kanpur, from his MB lakh funds, in talking about Arun Shuri. So we had heard about this in the newspapers, and we said, can we use this route to do something? So after some deliberation, we said that let us first bring the information out in the public domain. So what are the criminal cases that candidates actually face when they are filing their papers for nomination? Now, there were two options at that time. Do we ask for disqualification or disclosure? Our instinct was that if we ask for disqualification, we will lose the case. But on disclosure, we are likely to win. So we went to the courts. We had to fight for 4 or 5 years, because every time the government would challenge the judgment. And so we said, the Supreme Court, the High Court of Delhi first said, yes, they must declare this information. And then the political system hit back. They filed an appeal to the Supreme Court saying they don't want to give this information. So that case went on for 1.5 years. The Supreme Court said, no, every citizen, let me reach one of you sitting here, I assume most of you are over 18, have a right to know whom you're voting for and what is that person's background. And specifically the criminal record, the financial record, and the educational record. So this they must give in a sworn affidavit to the returning officer. And the court also said that this must be widely disseminated by the election commission or whoever wants to access this information. As soon as the Supreme Court gave this verdict, the government of India, or the Union of India, Parliament, introduced the Representation of People Amendment Act 2002, and they said that we will not give this information, and we are amending the law to say that you don't have to give this information. So when we went back to the court, we challenged the amendment as unconstitutional, and the court actually struck down the amendment as unconstitutional. So ever since then, people have been giving this information. For those of you who are young citizens, the court actually gave you a new right. So under the fundamental right, you know, freedom of expression, the court said that when you go and vote, you are exercising your fundamental right of freedom of expression, because you are expressing yourself by casting your vote. And to properly exercise that fundamental right, you need to know something about the candidates. And it's been enshrined in the Constitution that fundamental rights cannot be simply violated and overthrown by Parliament even if they don't like it. So that was said and reiterated once again by the Supreme Court, in spite of Parliament trying to overturn the amendment. So that was the first beginning of the story. And then we were very foolish. I don't know whether we are still foolish or not, but we were very foolish back then. We thought that once this information starts coming out, the whole political system would change. Now we are a little wiser and grayer, we realize that it's not so. So we started doing something called National Election Watch, and we took our traveling kit, so to say, and started traveling around the country. So from, you know, literally from Kashmir to Kanyakumari, and from Bombay to Calcutta and Northeast, we went to every state and tried to meet similar-minded organizations and said, look, do you want to join in National Election Watch? It basically means that this information, when it is available before the elections, we will help you also, and you should widely disseminate it among the public. So it was very good and heartening that lots of organizations actually joined. And now we have a state chapter in every state, including in Uttar Pradesh. And we were very encouraged when one of your colleagues, one of your professors here said that he would like to make it even more active in this part of the country. So people have found it worthwhile to do, those who are interested in the welfare of this country, and lots of people have joined. So through National Election Watch, we start disseminating this information. I'll tell you a little bit about this Election Watch because I'm actually motivated by seeing some of you young people here, so maybe some of you will find it worthwhile to do. You know, if you want to do something in the social field particularly, you must have some clear principles and what we call in modern jargon non-negotiable, and you should not negotiate, you should not deviate from that. Because the only thing you have is credibility, the only thing you have to say is that we are trying to do something useful for society. And if you don't do it properly, if you try to cut corners, if you make compromises, if you don't live by your values, then the whole thing falls down like a heap of cards. So I was also a student, I know all the things that students do. You have to write lab reports, you have to write assignments. Very often as professor, you don't know whether this report is written by this fellow or that fellow or all that leave it aside. But when you are doing social service, you cannot do these things. You have to be absolutely 100% ethical and correct on that, because you can't say that I want to make the system clean and free of corruption and use corrupt practices. Why I'm giving this principle, this is that we started doing that. So we said that if we want political parties and candidates to be transparent, first thing we say is that we will be transparent. We cannot say ki tum apni poll kholo aur main apni baat nahi bataunga. That's not true. That cannot be happening. So whatever you want from them, you have to impose on yourself. Then we decided we'll be scrupulously non-political and non-partisan. So we will not support any party, we will not oppose any party, etc., etc. And of course, we will follow all the ethical standards for managing money, accounts, etc. So that there is no. And we would also talk based on facts. So if you go to the ADR website, adrindia.org, and it has links to some other websites also, adrindia.org. The facts there have been verified, re-verified, cross-verified, you know, several times. In fact, if you find any error, you please tell us and we will try to correct it. But we hardly come across maybe a few instances in the last 10, 12 years. So always speak on facts and don't, you know, cast aspersions and don't sensationalize. And one must have a longer term vision ki yeh sab hum kyun kar rahe hain. See, all this technology and strategy and all that is fine, but in this work or any kind of social work, the basic question is why are you doing this? That should be clear to yourself, if not to others, because I'm hoping some of you will do better work than we have been able to do. So the idea is not to sensationalize and expose and make people look bad. Situation is bad, no doubt, but the idea really is to bring in healthy politics, healthy elections, so that we have good political leaders, good political parties, and therefore we get good governance and this great country moves forward. That is very clear in our mind. As a first step, we may be doing a little bit of exposure, but it's not merely the gand phailane ke liye nahi kar rahe. That's the, so as long as you are clear about that, you don't get into cheap sensationalism and just sort of trying to make a big noise and make a big splash. That is not the intention. So after doing this Election Watch, now we have been doing it for 12 years, now we are launching a major national campaign for the coming Lok Sabha elections. There are some issues which we have completely failed in, and I would like to place it before you. The first thing is that contrary to our expectations, exposure of even severe criminal record does not seem to make any difference to the great voting public of this country. About 3 months ago, I just finished analyzing about 62,800 records of every candidate who ever stood for elections in 2000. Every candidate who stood for any election in this country, either state assembly, Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha, we just finished analyzing it. And we asked some simple questions that are people with criminal record more likely to win? does money power play a role in elections? Basically, money and crime. These are two things, and there are many other issues about how do women candidates and elected representatives compare with men, and how educated and non-educated, all those things are there. But let me just focus on these two issues. And before I proceed, I would like to ask Professor Mishra or Grover that you please tell me when I have finished, because this is a long story, and I will finish whenever you give me about 5 minutes notice, and I will talk. And if the format permits, give me advance notice so that we leave some time for questions and answers if you think it's okay.
No, it's absolutely okay. In fact, to that extent, it's an informal interaction.
Right.
So what I would say is that, let's say 20 minutes is what you can use.
What? 20 more minutes to speak,
minutes,
and then we'll have a
And then we can ask after about another 10 15 minutes of interaction.
Okay. Thank you. So just give me, I request you to give me a little bit of notice because I'm not able to keep track. So, how do voters react to the criminal record? So, when you look at all these thousands and thousands of candidates, one simple question is, if you look at all the so-called clean candidates, that means who do not have any criminal record, what percentage of them win? It turns out that 12% of them win. If you look at all the candidates with some kind of a criminal record, and you ask what percentage of them win, it turns out 23% of them win. So you're almost twice as likely to win if you have a criminal record. Whether the voters are aware or not aware, if they're aware, they don't care. These are some questions that maybe if you have some questions later on, we will address them. Then we looked at serious criminal records, because there are criminal records like, you know, dharna, rasta roko, this and that, disturbing the public peace. But there are cases like murder, rape, you know, violent crimes, etc., etc. Non-bailable warrants, all those kind of serious crimes. We found that, again, if you look at all the candidates with serious criminal records, again, 23% of them win. So clearly the voters don't seem to consider this to be much of an issue, which is a very disturbing thing. So the problem, you know, as Shakespeare said, doesn't lie in our stars, the problem lies in us. That means there's no need only to blame the political party, but we as citizens also have somewhere not exercised our judgment. Then look at the money. The average declared assets of a candidate, all these 62,848 or something like that, all these candidates is 1.37 crores. That is what they have declared on paper. Let's not get into whether it's real or unreal or black money, white money. What they have declared in white is 1.37 crores is the average assets of a candidate. If you look at the average assets of a winner, it's 3.8 crores. So it's nearly three times. If you look at the average assets of somebody with a criminal record, it is 4.27 or something like that. From 3.8 it has gone to 4.27. And if you look at somebody with a serious criminal record, it has almost gone to 4.4. Candidate, winner, person with criminal record, person with serious criminal record. So this heady cocktail of crime and money, which is there in elections, is a matter of great concern, and it is no surprise that we are having the kind of governance that we see and read about in the newspapers. So if I'm driving from Lucknow to Kanpur, and then by the time you enter Kanpur, you see potholes and mess all around you, garbage lying around, it is directly a result of the kind of elected representatives that we have chosen. And I'll close this and then come to what we are trying to do, and maybe you have ideas on what can be done. The other thing is the role of big money in elections, which is very, very unfortunate. A former chief election commissioner, Dr. Qureshi, when he was CM, the last Uttar Pradesh assembly elections were held, and he made a public statement as a chief election commissioner, so I assume that he was speaking responsibly and conservatively. He said that 10,000 crores of black money would be spent during the Uttar Pradesh elections. So Uttar Pradesh mein 403 Vidhan Sabha ke seat hai, 403. So let's take it as 400. We divide 10,000 by 400, you guys are better at mathematics, some 25 crores per assembly seat. And there were four major parties, so on average 6 crores plus is what each candidate is spending. Give or take, rural areas little less, urban areas more, some candidates may be spending more, etc. Now the problem is, there are two problems with this spending of black money. Let's leave the corruption and the moral part of it out. I'm only looking at the spending of black money from the perspective of how it will deliver good or bad governance in Uttar Pradesh or anywhere else in the country for that matter. Some of you who are from North India will be happy to learn that South India mein aur bhi jyada paisa kharch karte hain because the economic growth and wealth is more, and in Punjab also they spend more money that way. So how does it impact good governance? Let's understand this very clearly. See, if I have a candidate and I spent 6 crore rupees to win an election, and I suppose I win, what will I do after winning? Will I do public service? What am I going to do? Yeah. So all of you have a good basic understanding of human nature. I will be trying to recover that money. Now, how will I recover that money? So you see, there is a connection between the potholes and the roads and this and that. So contracts, so mere bhai, bhatije, damad,